Tonight, 7 homes go up in flames in Rosehill on New Year's Day. Gunfire in Grass Street raises fresh concerns about the stigmatization of the inner city community. The opposition calls for the reinstatement of the distress fund to assist fire victims, and Port Castries prepares to host a record-setting 800,000 cruise passengers. Good evening. Welcome to the Thursday edition of the DBS News World. I am Kendall Burton. We start with news that 7 homes were completely destroyed after a fire tore through the community of Rosehill in Castries on New Year's morning. The incident occurred at approximately 1 a.m. The blaze has left several persons displaced and searching for answers. Alex Bousquet begins our newscast.
Officers attached to the Castries, Babuno and Grosile fire stations responded to the structural fire at Rosehill Castries in the early hours of January 1st, 2019. 4 fire appliances responded to that call.
When officers arrived on the scene, 4 structures were encountered fully engulfed. The fire was attacked from many strategic points simultaneously, before being controlled and subsequently extinguished. Preliminary assessment revealed that 7 houses were completely destroyed in the conflagration. Currently, the fire department is actively investigating the incident to determine the cause and origin. The management of the fire service wishes to acknowledge the hard work of fire officers for a speedy response and their professionalism to avert a potential disaster. Also, the police, Lucilec, and the rest of the public for their cooperation and assistance in the effort.
One Rosehill resident whose home was partially burnt in the blaze says he witnessed the origin of the fire.
Between 12:15 and 1 o'clock, I was at my home making my tea, and I heard that wire sparking. When I look out, I heard 2 other sparks. Then it caught a fire, and then the curtains in the house there started to burn. And the ceiling started burning too. And then the fire just started spreading in the house. And then it took the second house, and that was it. It just started to spread. Simple as that. It was no arson, anything like that. Just an electrical wire that went bad. Sparks and the curtains is this synthetic material. Just caught a fire and the fire started. Simple as that. 7 houses got burned, and it touched me so much that so many neighbors, one family lose 3 houses, and it's really sad. And all like now, so I'm feeling it in my chest, in my heart, my belly, everything. Yeah, simple as that. The people saying it's arson and it's boys that do that around here, but it's not that. I saw everything from beginning to end. I even helped in the fire extinguishing. My house started to catch a fire too, but I had some water there. I gave it some water and the wind changed direction and sent the fire on the other houses. But believe me, it's really, really, really sad.
Mr. Henville says some of the fire victims, although unhurt, will not be able to rebuild their homes. Fire officials, on the other hand, say in communities such as this one, where the structures are so close to each other and roads are narrow, the fire appliances face extreme difficulty maneuvering in and out and getting to such incidents quickly.
No doubt we encountered challenges while battling the blaze. One of them was the access roads were narrow, and that was compounded with vehicles parked on the side of the road, which made getting to the fire difficult. Also, when we got there, the structures were still energized, and that hampered our effort as well. Also, too, the nearby hydrants did not have so much pressure, and that made the water output a little less than desired. And the third of all, I think we had the proximity of the houses. When we got there, 4 of those structures were fully engulfed. But because of the proximity and the energized structure, we just could not have done better.
Mr. Antoine says if adequate allowances are not made for sufficient fire hydrants and fire appliances to maneuver, people will continue to lose their homes. Investigations into the cause of this blaze are continuing. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
Meanwhile, leader of the opposition, Philip Pierre, has called on the Alan Chastney-led administration to reinstate the distress fund to assist fire victims. The call follows the loss of 7 houses by fire on New Year's Day. The distress support fund was established by the St. Lucia Labour Party SLP government and was cancelled soon after the United Workers Party, or UWP, assumed office in 2016. More in this report.
The fund provides assistance to fire victims who are unable to afford insurance policies to cover their valuables. Such a fund, Mr. Pierre says, is critical and is needed to help families begin their recovery process at the soonest. A number of homes were destroyed by fire on New Year's Day at Rosehill in Castries, leaving several families homeless. Following a visit of the area, the opposition leader said that government has a responsibility to provide relief to the less fortunate.
Yes, I know that the distress fund has been discontinued, and I expect that at the time when it was, but I'm calling the government to assist these people immediately. You see, not many people can afford insurance because of the high rates of insurance, and these people, most of them, they don't have insurance, so the government should move and help them immediately. I'm also calling on society generally to assist these people because they are really in a desperate state and need of help.
Up to $500,000 was deposited in the fund yearly for the purpose of helping fire victims. An allocation, Mr. Pierce says, should be increased.
When the Labour Party gets back in the government, we are going to reinstate it immediately and increase it, primarily for the people who cannot afford insurance, because of the high rates of insurance.
3 out of the 7 homes destroyed belong to one family. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
In other news, Grass Street residents are expressing fresh concerns about gun violence in the inner city neighborhood after 2 men reportedly opened a fire in the community in the early hours of Thursday morning. It is unclear who the target of their actions was. While no injuries were recorded, residents say such incidents continue to haunt and cause the neighborhood to be stigmatized. More from Sheffield.
2019 began with the usual revelry, but no sooner had the fireworks died down than the sound of gunfire began echoing through central Castries. According to reports, 2 masked men entered the community on foot around 2 a.m. and opened fire before retreating into the dark. Luckily, no one was injured. The situation, however, has left community members concerned for their safety and that of their loved ones.
I have children running up and down. Well, not only me, but the entire community. We have children, so I am concerned about the crime that's happening.
Mr. Richardson says once individuals are incarcerated, there are not enough programs to assist with their rehabilitation.
They are not being educated in terms of their moral, knowing exactly what the true value is in terms of hurting up each other for no reason whatsoever. I'm thinking it may not be for drugs, it may not be for millions of dollars. It's like, you don't like me, I don't like you, you're watching me, I'm watching you, that's my turf, that's your turf. It doesn't make any sense.
He's also pleading with the youth to put down the guns and find better ways to resolve conflict. In 2018, the island recorded 43 homicides, many of which were gun-related. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Government is seeking to maximize benefits of cruise tourism. Tourism Minister Dominic Fede says efforts are being intensified to ensure the benefits of cruise tourism are felt throughout the community. The minister spoke as Port Castries remains on track to host a record-setting 800,000 cruise passengers. We get details in this report.
Port Castries was busy with cruise ship activity as 2018 drew to a close with 3 mega ships berthed there in the final weekend of the year. At one point, there were 5 ships in the harbour, an indication of a strong winter season for the cruise sector.
The economic spin-offs are nothing but tremendous. I've just come from visiting Port Serafin and, you know, everyone is selling. It's good to see that the taxi drivers are making trips as well. And I think this is the beginning of the success that we can have as a destination if we do cruise tourism right.
Minister Fede says the ultimate objective is for the economic benefits of cruise tourism to be felt through every sector. To this end, government is undertaking a study aimed at improving revenue flows.
We want to make sure that small business people, vendors, taxi drivers, shop owners, that everyone can feel the tourism dollar. We have actually done a lot of training already.
Efforts have begun to help all sectors maximize returns from cruise tourism. Over 150 vendors have been trained in sales techniques and product development, with the industry reporting a 13% growth over the previous year, 2017. Government is advancing plans to further decentralize the benefits of cruise porting. A record-setting 800,000 cruise passengers are expected to visit the island this cruise season, which runs from November 2018 to May 2019. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Busquet.
Time now to join Alex Busquet for Street Vibes.
Hi, I'm Alex Busquet, and you're watching Street Vibes. Today, the people speak to an open mic.
The square was great. Everything was in place. But the only thing I really find, they had too many young children on their own, unsupervised. That means no parents around, as low as 13 years, 12 years on their own. So parents, be alert. Let us watch our children a little bit more.
As a returning national to St. Lucia after 21 years, I find that there is an uneasiness around with our people. There seem to be some issues that is unsolved, and it's very concerning because if not addressed, I'm afraid that it might develop into something much more drastic. So my advice to everyone is just take it easy. Life is not easy, but we have to make it the best, as livable as we can.
I wish everybody, man, a pleasant and a happy new year, and just stop the violence and just live a nice and positive life, man. And let's big up and stop them negative thoughts. Right now, positive, we deal with, man. New year, everything has to change.
For this new year, I am wishing the best for everybody and stop the crimes and so on, you know, and these kind of things like that. I myself am not a crimist. I'm a tailor, all right? So I wishing everybody should change their lives and these kind of things like that, like the alcohol thing and these kind of things, although I'm drinking some alcohol, but I need to change also, you understand what I'm saying?
In 2019, all I want is for the government to fix up the mini-fleet park for us so we could train our athletes better, right? Because the condition is not good, and the mini-fleet park has produced a lot of international athletes, okay? People like Makiba, Levin Spencer, John Alfred, and yet still our field in a bad condition.
Well, there you have it. You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Busquet, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
You're watching St. Lucia's television and news leader and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5. We're also online on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. Still to come, a library to feature prominently in this year's Nobel Laureate Festival activities, and the Chamber of Commerce hosts a one-day seminar on the Labour Code. Welcome back. A visual arts festival in Labrie will be among the highlights of activities to celebrate the island's two Nobel laureates, Sir Derek Walcott and Sir Arthur Lewis. The activities will span the entire month of January. Don Nicholas has details.
Coordinator of the Nobel Laureate Festival, Delia Dolor, welcomes meaningful contributions from members of the public to this year's Nobel Laureate Festival. Activities to celebrate the lives of Nobel laureates Sir Derek Walcott and Sir Arthur Lewis, who were both born on January 23rd, include a lecture series focusing on their achievements. Apart from his lecture on economics at England's Manchester University, Sir Arthur Lewis was also very instrumental in ensuring that Caribbean people had a say in that community. In fact, there's a building in Manchester named after him, and this year's event will also be celebrated in that city.
And we also have an event in the UK with the Manchester University, who are putting together a series of videos to highlight Sir Arthur, because there is a building there named after him. But coming across to St. Lucia, of course, we have St. Mary's College presenting Warrior, Standing for Love. And it's a very creative display of song and dance and spoken word.
There will also be an Awards of Excellence, a book fair, and a Walcott House Open Week. There will also be a visual arts festival in Labrie on January 26th and 27th, where members of the public who are skilled at painting can come and display their talents in a Paint the Village activity under the guidance of American artist Jonathan Gladding, who gave up his job as a computer artist for Sesame Street to come to St. Lucia as a Peace Corps volunteer in 1999. He fell in love with the country and has been living in Labrie ever since.
And of course, Paint the Village, that's become very popular over the years. We have Paint the Village, Paint Our History with Jonathan Gladding. And that's the fourth time we're going to do this two-day community-based visual arts festival. And this year it's going to focus on Labrie's historical industrial heritage. So they're going to be looking at painting different sites in Labrie. So it doesn't matter what level of painting, whether you can or you can't. Everyone just goes there and they start painting, and Jonathan will come and guide you, and everyone has a wonderful time.
Sir Derek Walcott won the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1992, and Sir Arthur Lewis captured the Award for Economics in 1979. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
Castries Southeast MP Guy Joseph is calling on St. Lucians to unite in 2019. Meanwhile, the leader of the opposition, Philip Jaipierre, is challenging St. Lucians to embrace the spirit of hope. The two MPs were delivering their New Year's messages. Don Nicholas reports.
World developments, according to Castries Southeast MP Guy Joseph, make it difficult for smaller countries like St. Lucia to survive. 2018, he says, came with its challenges, but the country has been able to weather the storms. As a result, the parliamentary representative is calling on St. Lucians to unite and uplift each other as he hopes for a better 2019.
I look forward to bigger and better things in 2019. As we continue to work together to make our communities better.
Castries East MP Philip Jaipierre echoed similar sentiments. He called on the nation to embrace the spirit of hope, notwithstanding the many challenges they have had to grapple with. He noted that many citizens are in need of care and attention, like the sick, the unemployed, the abused, and those who are close to giving up, because there appears to be no end to their pain and suffering.
I called on the government for greater engagement of the gifts and talents of all our people for the common good. But this message has fallen on deaf ears. I repeat the call for more inclusive and tolerant society.
Mr. Pierre expressed gratitude to the people of Castries East for their unwavering support. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce will continue its series of information sessions for members with a Know Your Labour Code seminar. The full-day event takes place on Thursday, 31st January 2019, and is facilitated by Mistress Cheryl Goddard-Dorville of Goddard-Dorville Legal. Since the enactment of the Labour Act in 2006 with amendments in 2013, there has been a high incidence of claims by employees against employers. The Chamber says the costs and implications of such litigation are obvious. And in that context, and in response to specific requests from members, it has decided to host the one-day workshop on the code, with particular focus on the subject of termination, among other topics down for discussion. Other topics include valid reasons for dismissal, constructive dismissal, warnings and termination for misconduct, unsatisfactory performance, and natural justice safeguards. Time now to join Alex Buske for this week's edition of Everyday People.
Meet Lindell Moncheri, better known as Javas, a young man who's picked up the hobby of crab catching from a tender age.
I'm a little boy. I start taking crab like a nature to me, you know, because my month is a crab month. So to deal with crab, you must know about crab. So when I was a little boy, I used to see my father go and catch crab. So I watched my father, watch how my father used to make the crab traps as the teens. So I used to take it from there. And I grew up, little boy now, I ended up getting to know crab selling mat, make big money. But I was a little boy, I could not really, you know. So I used to catch it, and give to my mother to sell for me. My mother gave me the money. Sometimes I don't know how much, but she gave me money. I like it because, so I just pick it up like a habit.
Java says he hunts crabs all over the city circuit.
I know I go much tapier, VG. Yeah, I go by the seaside. That's where you get the more clean crabs. You understand? You can go under people's house, people to say your mako in them, and people yard, people to say vole, hotel aku. You know, understand them kind of thing? So the embarrassment, you're avoiding it. But different time, the afternoon time, when you pull some them see you, they'll harass you because they see you have a sack. And it's late night and you're rushing on a bicycle, you know what you have. But when they stop and they ask you, telling them it's crabs. When you show them the crabs, they say, they're digging out, you're going to say, a young guy like you, that I tell them, yeah. Rather you go and do crime, you go and do something, you go to the crab. That keep you out of crime. You understand? It's an income too.
The skilled crab catcher has come up with more innovative ways to catch the crabs. He has switched from the traditional tin traps to PVC traps.
It's a thing you have to think. It's just thinking is your mind. Because when you watch the PVC, it seems wrong. You have to cut it to an angle and find a way. So when you bend the galvanized, so it will not bend out, it will less bend in. So if it bend in, when it go in, it can come back out. So you have to get a special cut for special size. You understand? So when it go in, the crab cannot pass on the side, and it cannot raise it. But when it fall, it will fall. So the crab will have to just stay and wait for you.
The crawling creatures go through a cleaning process before they are put into the holding cage.
When I catch them from beginning, I put them in the drum. I clean them from in the drum. I make them spend about a 2 or 3 or 4 days in the drum. About, let me say, 5 days in the drum. From in the drum, I transfer them, I put them in the cage. From that you reach inside, that means you're well clean, you're good to go. You're ready to eat.
The crabs, he says, gets cleaned twice a day, just as he showers.
Every day. Sometimes they get beef twice a day. And I save this beef twice a day, so I beef my crab twice a day. You understand, in the morning and also in the evening, because as you could see, the sun is hot them days.
The final process, Java says, is getting paid for his hard hunting and caretaking.
Well, just wait patiently when the guys come from on the boat to get my euro. That's the fun about it. that's the end of the product, you understand? Yeah. Wait when the guys come. Now I know from today I'll get famous because people will be coming from all over and come and get their fresh crabs in the cage because they're seeing other crabs well eating. Those crabs is healthy crabs, ain't it?
Lindell Moncherry, alias Javas, who hails from Fuasho at Hospital Road in Castries, says crab catching is a sustainable hobby. At least for him it is. For Everyday People, I am Alex Buske.
When the DBS News World continues, organizers of this year's ASU Square festivities say it was a huge success. Welcome back. The United Nations has finally approved of the January 4th birth date of Louis Braille, inventor of Braille, as World Braille Day. Braille is a form of written language for blind people in which characters are represented by patterns of raised dots that are felt with their fingertips. Here's Don Nicholas with that story.
Executive Director of the St. Lucia Blind Welfare Association, Anthony Avril, gave full credit to the World Blind Union for its efforts to get United Nations recognition for the observance of World Braille Day. Braille is a form of written language that allows the visually impaired contact with the written word. With UN recognition, Mr. Avril is hoping that more will be done at international level to make life in general easier for the visually impaired.
A lot of credit must be given to the WBU, the World Blind Union, who have been the principal advocate to getting the UN to recognize the significance of that day. As you know, Braille is the only system that gives blind persons, actually totally blind persons, direct physical contact with the written word.
The event is celebrated every year on January 4th because it's the birthday of Louis Braille, the inventor of Braille. Louis was born in 1809 in France, and he became blind after a childhood accident. And by the age of 15, he quickly mastered Braille as his new way of living.
It was invented by Louis Braille. He suffered blindness through some childhood incidents. And as a child, he thought, well, look, if sighted children can read, there must be a way for blind children to read as well. So by the time he was 15 years old, he had completed the original alphabet for the Braille system.
Over the years, Braille was tweaked to make it easier to read, and now it's used the world over. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
The CEO of the Castries Constituency Council says the ASU Square activities for 2019 were a huge success. The large number of young persons and children in attendance came as a surprise to the council, and as they go back to the drawing board to plan next year's activity, the CEO says new strategies will be implemented to better entertain the influx of young people expected at next year's event. More from Alex Puske.
The ASU Square activity for 2019, according to the CEO of the City Council, apart from a few hiccups here and there, was a success.
Well, as you know, the ASU Square is an initiative of the Office of the Mayor, and it is something that we normally implement every year. This year, it was a total success. We were surprised by the amount of crowd, especially a lot of young people. But we catered for them in terms of the activities that we had. We try to broaden or to create additional space by Constitutional Park and the Boulevard. So it was a very, very, very good success. And we already start planning for next year. And we really want to thank some of the people that were behind the scenes, especially our major coordinator, that's Ms. Mr. Edwards. And so it went well. I mean, the mayor was satisfied, people were satisfied. But there are one or two things that we really have to do, especially with the lighting of Bourbon Street, I think. We need to enhance that. But overall, it went very, very well.
The city police, along with officers of the RSLPF, Mr. Pierre says, kept the two-day activity safe, with only two minor incidents being reported. He says plans are already being made to make this a national event an even bigger one. Mr. Pierre also commended the ground staff of the CCC for cleaning up the city in record time.
And if you look at today, when I left here last night, the place was in a mess. But if you look this morning, you'll see how clean the city is if you compare it with what was there last night, because you know what people do, they just dump their garbage there and things. So our sanitation persons were excellent. They work all 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock in the morning when people are sleeping, after they enjoy themselves, they're sleeping. We have some of our workers come in there and actually work in. And these are some of our daily paid workers. And these are the people that we really, really appreciate because of the hard work that they do. When the activity is done, they're still there working as vigilant as ever. And if you look at the streets now, you'll see a total different from what it was after the event. So I think overall, we really have to compliment our staff, especially our sanitation persons.
Noting a few areas which could have done with more lighting, the City Council's CEO says all this and more will be addressed in the future. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
Stay tuned, the DBS News World will continue after these messages. On the lighter side tonight, condolences have been flooding in for a Kentucky police department that shared photos of officers being brought to tears by a donut truck fire. The Lexington Police Department said no one was injured when a Krispy Kreme truck hauling a load of donuts burst into flames while driving on a local road. A witness captured video from the scene showing flames and smoke pouring from the truck. The police department tweeted photos of officers paying respect to the fallen donuts by feigning tears, leading to supportive replies from other departments. "We are so deeply sorry for your loss," the Staunton Police Department wrote. "Your brothers and sisters in Massachusetts are here for you during these tough times." The New York Police Department joked a jet was being sent to replace the charred pastries. "Hang tight. We are sending backup forthwith," and these guys came prepared. We hope you like sprinkles, the department tweeted. And that's your lighter side and our news. Before we go, let's take one more look at our top stories. Seven homes go up in flames in Rosehill on New Year's Day. Gunfire in Grass Street raises fresh concerns about the stigmatization of the inner city community. The opposition calls for the reinstatement of the distress fund to assist fire victims, and Port Castries prepares to host a record-setting 800,000 cruise passengers. And that's the DBS News World for today, Thursday, 3rd January 2019. I'm Kendall Burton. Thanks for watching. Good evening.